Good afternoon and welcome to the 27th meeting of 2023 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. This week we are pleased to be meeting in Aberdeen. This is the first time the Economy and Fair Work Committee has met outside of Holyrood in this session, and I thank Aberdeen City Council very much for hosting us in this magnificent room. Our first item of business is a decision to take item 3 in private. Are members content to do so? Thank you. So our next item of business is the first evidence session of an inquiry into a just transition for the North East and Moray. Industry is the second highest carbon emitting sector in Scotland after transport, and there's currently a target of 2045 for Scotland to cut greenhouse gas emissions to net zero. The committee is interested in looking at how we can support, incentivise and de-risk this transition to benefit industry and the community. I would like to thank those who have responded to our call for views, as well as everyone who took part in our engagement workshop this morning. All the views expressed will be considered as part of our inquiry. I'd also like to thank the staff at Aberdeen South Harbour for hosting a visit from us this morning. We now move to our evidence session, and I welcome Stuart Bewes, Programme Manager, Aberdeen City Council, Jim Grant, Head of Economic Growth and Development with Moray Council, Alistair Ross, Policy and Consultations Officer with Aberdeen Council of Voluntary Organisations and with Aberdeenshire Voluntary Action, and Alison Stewart, Hub Manager, North East Scotland Climate Action Network. Paul McCarry from Aberdeenshire Council has given his apologies for this meeting for understandable reasons. Before we start questions, I'll invite Maggie Chapman to declare an interest.
Thanks very much, Convener. Just to note for colleagues, I'm a member of the NESCAN board, so just to have that on record.
Okay, thank you. And if members and witnesses can keep their answers as concise and direct as possible, that means we can get more questions in this afternoon. If I maybe start, this does reflect on some of the discussions we've already had today, and ask the panel how they would define a just transition. What would a just transition for North East and Moray look like? And I might come to some of the people who helped us out this morning, as you've already had a go at answering this question, but I'll come to you first, Alison, if you would like to.
Well, I think firstly we do need a vision for the North East of Scotland, Moray, Aberdeen City and Aberdeenshire. That's a joint vision with all members, parts of our society involved in that creation of it. We have done in NESCAN quite a lot of visioning exercises, both for COP26 and after that point in time. And so I know the kind of broad strokes of what the communities think and people within communities think they want for just transition. And that really focuses in around a holisticness, a localism, so that they can have everything that they want in walking, biking distance, that they have the ability to grow food locally, and that they have local decision making. So that is very clear as well. And green space is crucial, biodiversity, and really when we're thinking about that kind of drawing of it, it's that green byways for walking, for biking, it's the localised industry, it's the retrofitted, so it's kind of warm, cheap houses to run, it's the renewables on buildings, it is the justness in relation to equity, and the healthiness as well that comes from having things locally, things well thought out so people can walk, can cycle, can access nature as well, because those things are crucial. So I think that's really important, is that whereas we might ask lots of people and they'll come up with that vision, a very similar vision, when it comes to implementing in their community, in their environment, the details will change. So it's really quite place-based.
Thank you. Jim, if I may come to you from Moray Council, if you want to give a view of what does the council understand a just transition to be, and how will we know when that has been achieved or delivered?
Yeah. So I think in terms of government policies around both programme for government, but national planning framework for national strategy for economic transformation, I think government has set out that vision and ambition for what just transition should look like, but I think there's still a huge challenge in how we get there, particularly in terms of where investment goes when we're trying to address inequalities and inequalities in the economy that have perhaps built up over decades. Certainly in rural Scotland, population decline is a big issue. I can only see that getting worse with some of the elements of transition, particularly around transport, and how we ensure that that is just both for rural areas and city areas as we try and tackle carbon and climate change issues.
Mm-hmm. And then Stuart, if I come to you, because you're Aberdeen City Council, it's quite different in terms of the challenges, or it might be the same. Do you want to say how the council defines a just transition and what they're working towards?
Thank you. Aberdeen City Council's got a number of strategies and policies. I wouldn't say that they're necessarily directly focused on a just transition. Typically in the area, we've had a focus on climate change action plans, and we've looked at an energy transition. I think the part around the just transition has been to some extent defined by the Scottish Government. I think the challenge that we feel as a local authority is how do we move towards this idea of the just transition, which is far more socially equitable. And I think one of the areas where there's perhaps a bit of a lack of clarity at the moment is the idea of what is it we're trying to do. If we look at the Just Transition Fund and the objectives that it has, we can see logic in them. I think the difficulty is which organisations would take a lead on that and how would they do it. So as a local authority, I guess the commitment that we have is to try and work with all of our local stakeholders to try and support that. But I'm not sure that it's something that as a local authority we'd be able to do on our own. And just one other question that you had asked was around how would we measure a just transition? I think that's an excellent question. I don't know the answer, but I think if we know how we might measure that, I think that would help us in terms of shaping what we need to do to get to that point.
Because we were interested in whether there's enough, because if we're looking at a place-based just transition and whether we have enough knowledge and data around what is, you know, can we measure? Is there anything that is tangible that we could see within a local authority area?
Potentially. So, for example, we have indicators, the SIMD indicators, for example. We were actually having a conversation out in the other room about this, where we're saying the difficulty in using those as your basis is that impacts that you may achieve through this fund, it's not instantly recognisable because they're done over such a long term. My feeling is that we would want to measure impacts far sooner than that, and we'd be able to measure the immediate impact and outcome of those investments, but actually what they do on a larger scale in the context of SIMD, that's going to take much, much longer, and it will take other factors into account beyond just what we're doing specifically to address a just transition.
Mm-hmm. I suppose from what you say, I don't know if Stuart and Jim maybe want to respond back to this, is from what you say, is it fair to take reasoning that you feel the Scottish Government has understanding of what just transition is and what they're wanting to achieve, but you are probably some of the key delivery partners. Is there enough support or communication about, is there a shared understanding of what's trying to get delivered? Is it clear enough what they're actually trying to deliver? I don't know, Stuart, if I come to you, then Jim, I'll give you a chance and I'll come to Alistair.
I think that's the challenge, and we can see from the Scottish Government's publications, you know, what you intend for that to mean and the timescales associated. As a local government, though, we're recognising that some of those key sectors in there are not necessarily sectors that we're having a direct responsibility for. There was a mention around transport and industry and the kind of the accountability or the responsibility that they hold for emissions. There are policy drivers we can put in place, but actually in terms of the financial investment that's needed to change that, I think that possibly goes beyond what we as a local authority would be able to achieve on our own, even with the national guidelines that are there. You mentioned the place-based approach, and that is something that we've had support from the Scottish Government on through the Place-Based Investment Fund. We continue to administer that. That tends to be more community-focused and smaller-scale initiatives. But I think when we have, within the context of Place-Based Investment Fund, there's a clear strategy there that we're able to go and implement because we have the responsibility for the place. So that sits really nicely with us. I think with the Just Transition, it's a far broader remit, and not all of which necessarily would sit within the power of a local authority itself.
Mm-hmm. And Jim, do you want to respond?
Yeah, so I think in Murray we're fortunate in terms of size or scale of the area that we're working with, in that we work very closely with partners. So the council has an ambition around being net zero by 2030 in terms of climate change. But we have the Climate Assembly that's operated by Moray TSI, which the council participate along with the community and the private sector in that Climate Assembly. We have good connections in with UHI Moray, who are delivering on skills, and one of their early Just Transition projects is looking at the gap in green skills for the Moray area and what can be done. So I think from a community planning perspective and partners across both Highland Islands Enterprise, UHI Moray, the council and the community, I think we're well placed to work out what needs to be done, but we are reliant on the funding to enable that to be done. And I think that some of the delivery of Just Transition Fund has perhaps not been communicated as well as it could be, or should I say planned as far in advance as it could be. It feels like we've been a bit reactive, which is understandable for the first round that was done, but I think longer term planning over the future years would help particularly community groups, but also local authorities in UHI Moray in how we move forward and the capacity within some of those bodies to develop projects, I think is important.
Thank you. Alistair, I'll come back to you and come back to the start of the question. Do you feel there's a shared understanding of what a just transition means?
No. I think there's a bit of a disparity between how communities and the third sector are included in the discussions with the private sector and the public sector around that vision. Communities don't tend to feel that they have the same level of influence when they're in discussions or in meetings. So it's important that communities are not just listened to, but they have the power themselves and, more importantly, the resources themselves to make changes in their places. But also, say, communities are not just about places, they're about communities of people as well that have shared characteristics or shared interests, and so it's not all about place. Certainly when trying to make a just transition, we know at the moment we're not including all parts of our communities that should have a voice, and those are communities of people that rather than places, and so that's an important consideration, we would say, from the third sector as well. So yeah, at the moment, I would say in Aberdeen City and Aberdeenshire that it's the transition that's dominating in the moment, and it's dominated by the transition from the energy perspective, with the voices of those big companies and deep pockets, and the communities don't have that parity of a voice.
Mm-hmm. And then before I come to Colin Smith, when we talked about how do you measure a just transition, do you think a set of kind of agreed, measurable targets or indicators would be helpful? Because we have ambitions and targets set, but how do we know if we're actually delivering them? I'm not asking you to come up with what the set might be, but would something like that be helpful? Jim, if I come to you.
Yeah, I think a set of measures is helpful. It does help guide projects and helps to develop, if you like, the baselines for those measures, whatever they may be, early, so that you can show change and you can show benefit over with the progress of the projects. I think what's difficult is a set of measures that really captures the full breadth of a just transition, because it does range from very significant transport projects down to very small communities and how we address some of their issues and barriers.
Mm. Is anyone else on the panel want to respond to that? Alistair, did you?
Because how do you measure the social impact of this? That's what's very, very important. We can have X number of jobs or X number of projects, or but how do you measure that wider social impact of providing a bus service to a community that's isolated? Rather than counting the number of journeys, what does that actually do for a community? In the same way, providing employment opportunities for people in new green industries is a much wider social benefit to that. And how how is that measured? Because that's the justness of the transition, and that's not the easy bit to measure.
Alison.
Just to come in, I mean, obviously, when you're talking about measurements, you first need a plan to measure against. So I think you need the vision, and then you need the plan. And then from the plan, you will get the indicators or the KPIs. But measurement is very tricky. So being a regional hub, we're trying at the moment to create indicators that really can show the wider social impact. It's going to be very difficult. It's something that is long term. It's something that's very, very nebulous. How do you measure the increase in confidence in a community, the increased capacity? But that is, we have to have a new thinking about monitoring, learning, and evaluation that isn't just about economic indicators and figures, but a much deeper way of actually measuring change, because that's what the transition's all about, really.
Mm-hmm. Alistair, I'll let you briefly come back, and then I'll go to Colin Smith.
Thanks, and I do understand the nature of the world that we work in, but short-term measures or quick wins are no use for communities. Well, it's sustained investment in long-term funding and long-term projects over, you know, it's not 2 or 3 years or 5 years, it's 10, 15, 20 years that you're looking at to really change a community. So that was that point.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Colin Smith. Followed by Michael Chapman.
Thanks very much, convener. Can I just follow up on a point you touched on, Alistair, regarding community engagement? We had obviously an excellent session this morning with community groups, and what struck me was that the huge amount of fantastic work that's taking place across communities, but you seem to be suggesting that the communities don't feel sufficiently empowered to shape that just transition in the Northeast. Can you say a bit more about that point you made there? Is there good examples of where that empowerment is taking place at the moment that we can take away, or what needs to be changed in order to better involve those communities?
Yeah, I think probably and I don't think we've done them yet, but Alison, maybe we can confirm me, things like citizens' assemblies, where you have selected a broad range of opinions at the start, you know, a whole different range of people from a community who then actually have decision-making powers and some money behind them to do projects in their local area. Those are places that are successful. When you talk about communities, they're also hugely different. You have some communities that are full of very active people who have a whole range of skills. Those tend to be areas that are wealthy anyway, and they can quite easily do community projects or start up green businesses, and there are loads of examples of those that we could share with you. But that's not the just part of it. Those communities can already do that. It's how do we get the resources and build the capacity in those communities that don't have those skills and don't have those people, and definitely don't have the power or the resources to do it.
So what do we need to do to change that then?
So we have to be a bit more, it's about local democracy really, very localised democracy, but I would say. And I know there's discussions about that in government and parliament just now.
If Alison wants to.
Yeah, I do. I think really what you can do is you have to think about how to build capacity. So the funding, you know, 1 year funding and the kind of things you have to do make it quite difficult, because really to be successful, you need to put time in the front to actually build relationships in the community and trust and know who to bring in to community assemblies to really be able to have a diversity of representation so that every bit of that community is actually represented, because that really brings a buy-in for the community as a whole much, much easier. And alongside that, there has to be the kind of education and really capacity building within that community to come up with a plan to then, as Alistair was saying, to be able to support the community in that plan and have some community commissioning. So the money has to be there for those projects, but also the support, the people support from something like NESCAN, you know, to really be able to empower those people so they can go and then do that by themselves. But it's really important that is really quite intensive in relation to financial and people resources. But the only way you can build capacity is by people, time and energy, really.
Okay, that's really helpful. My colleague's going to have some specific questions around how the local authority engage with UK and Scottish government, but I suppose I want to focus on how the council engage with communities, and turning to yourself, Stuart, and Jim, I mean, what changes have you made as local authorities to the way you engage communities as we begin to address that need for a just transition? I was at a table this morning, Stuart, with a group of people from Tory, and I won't mention a particular park, but there was a general feeling that communities don't feel maybe the local authorities engaging them enough to allow them to really shape that transition at local authority level. So what sort of changes has the local authority made to try to better engage people, or what do you plan to maybe do in the future?
Thank you. I think some of the things that we've seen, the council has a local outcome improvement plan that brings together a whole range of local stakeholders who are shaping the policy decisions of the council. And all of the reports that we're bringing through committees, we have to be able to address that local outcome improvement plan. So there's a commitment from everything that we do to try and have a positive impact on that plan that's been put together by the council along with other stakeholders. But I think probably the crux of your question is not so much about that strategic element, it's more about the kind of the practicalities. And that's always been a challenge, not just for the City Council, I think for most local authorities, is to understand that what we're trying to achieve here is for the communities to work with us, not for us to work with them. That feeling is often one of, oh, here comes the local authority to tell us what we have to do or what they're going to do to us. Trying to change that around by getting early engagement with the communities. And what we've often found is that organisations, so obviously Alistair's from ACFO, they have a really good relationship already with a lot of these community groups. And so it's how do we work with ACFO to make sure that the messages that are coming through from the community, we can tie into those, and that we can improve proper genuine consultation with the communities. What we don't want to see is a situation whereby we think something is good because on a strategic level it fits, to then understand that it's not actually what the community wants. It feels like it's being done to a community. So that's where that piece, before any kind of plans and decisions are made, we want that early engagement. And I think part of what we're seeing and what we discussed, if I just bring this back around to the just transition piece, is that when we take this in the context of just transition, that's a really difficult conversation because I don't think we're probably clear as to how do we measure a just transition. What's that conversation about? How do we engage in a way that everyone is clear as to what we're trying to do? And just to pick up on something that Alison had said in terms of the funding, one of the key things that gives us a real challenge around the Just Transition Fund is that it's a capital-only fund. And in order to mobilise communities and groups and allow them to take forward ideas and initiatives, revenue funding alongside that would be a huge boost to them.
Support them. I mean, Jim, obviously, you mentioned earlier the Citizens Assembly that you have in there. I mean, how does that shape policy in your area, and how do you get to those, I suppose, harder-to-reach groups to make sure it's not, you know, community groups that maybe we all know about in our area, but it's actually people with those groups even are influencing your policies in your area?
Yeah, so I think the Climate Assembly I mentioned is a specific assembly run by Murray TSI, or TSI Murray, around climate change and energy and renewable energy. So it brings together both communities, public sector and private sector organisations who are specifically interested in addressing those issues around renewable energies in particular. On general community engagement, as a local authority, we already do extensive engagement around things like local outcome improvement plan, place plans for those areas experiencing specific inequalities that we deal with. We have engagement under planning for master plans. All our main town centres have recently had town centre improvement plans with significant community engagement, and climate change and net zero and the implications of that have all been part of that planning process, looking at how communities need to change, what can be built in terms of active travel, etc., for that. And we're currently going through local development plan for 2027 and having that engagement with communities around, well, what does that look like? How do we bring MPF4 policies into this? And the ideas around just transition and climate change is all built throughout those whole policies, so it's starting that conversation with communities around what they want to see and what they think is important. I think the difficulty engaging directly on funding and looking or getting communities excited about projects in their area and coming forward with the ideas more is that piece I mentioned earlier about being able to long-term plan. So if we had a profile of the Just Transition Fund even over the next 5 years and we knew what that makeup was, that gives communities something to say, we can aim for that with the right capacity funding to help a community grow and develop a project. They know that if we bid into here, there's going to be a pot of money that we can bid in for. Whereas at the moment, there's a bit of uncertainty around, is it going to be capital funding or is it going to be, Scottish National Investment Bank funding, which perhaps isn't suitable for some of the community projects.
I'd be pleased to know there's lots of questions on the fund coming shortly, I think.
Thank you, Chapman.
And good afternoon to the panel. Thank you for joining us. Stuart, if I can start with you, you talked about, you used the phrase genuine consultation and early engagement. And I'm interested in how you understand, thinking about broader community empowerment principles, how you understand that as different to co-production.
I think that's probably the phrase I was looking for, is we feel the ideas exist within the community, and I guess part of the role of the local authority is how do we support those ideas to come forward. Now, there are other organisations that we would work with in doing that. Some of them are sitting here today. I think what we want to be clear on insofar as the just transition aspect is that locally and regionally, and nationally too, sorry, there are policies and strategies in place, and I guess what we're looking to pull together is these ideas within the communities. How do we actually help to demonstrate that strategic fit? One of the things that we've become aware of is that often there are good ideas just not quite linked up with other good ideas, and that's a key thing that we feel as a local authority we can help. So that's where we want that engagement, that consultation, because we're having a number of conversations. We can't have everyone around every table, it becomes counterproductive. So it's how do we link up the right organisations and the right ideas so that they can maximise the benefit of those ideas.
Okay, thanks, that's helpful. So there's that work happening, or you're attempting to try and support communities to bring their expertise, because it's expertise we're talking about, it's expertise and experience together in different ways. What are the structures that are preventing you from doing that? We've heard about funding, and I know there'll be other questions about funding. What are the structures that are preventing you from doing that in an effective way that transcends some of the, or if we dealt with those, we would be able to get that sort of cross-community collaboration and rather than genuine consultation, genuine co-production of a long-term strategy for just transition?
I think the big challenge that we have is around the expectation management. We would love to be able to go out and say, have these conversations, but actually from round one, we still don't know when round two is going to be. We don't know how that's going to look. We have other funds that we administer as a local authority, and we've had a bit of clarity around what that's going to be year on year. I think it was 4 or 5 years, for example, for the place-based investment fund. So that's allowed us to go out and promote that, and we do that already. And we've seen a strong number of local initiatives come forward and be delivered really successfully. The challenge here is we don't want to raise those expectations and find that we've encouraged groups to take forward initiatives and ideas, but actually there's no means to go and deliver them. So that's probably a key bit, I think, that would allow us to actually really go and push this. And I think one of the things that's perhaps not been addressed, and I appreciate there are questions around the fund later, but we are seeing at the moment that the fund comes out and it's then kind of open for everybody with a very broad remit. The role of local authority in doing that is really difficult to promote because we have so many questions from so many different sectors about how they can access the fund, and we don't always have a huge amount of information either on that. So I think more knowledge and sort of a better indication of those timescales would be the key thing to allow us to have those conversations.
Okay, so there's something in there about how the Scottish Government and others who support that fund, there's a communication, there's an information issue there, never mind the strategic work that needs to happen. Jim, can I come to you? Similar kind of question. What is it that, how is it that you and Marie, where are the barriers to co-production and actually seeing the creativity, the skills, the expertise of local community groups actually come to fruition in a planned and strategic way?
I'll pick up on Alistair's point earlier that in some communities that happens because they have capability within the community. They've perhaps benefited for a number of years from wind farm community benefit, and therefore the structures within that community enable them to come together and push things forward. Other communities haven't had that community benefit. They perhaps haven't got the same capacity within the community. And the only way you get into those areas and really build that capacity is from organisations such as Alistair's and Alison, or council staff going into those areas and providing support. And our limiting capacity is the staff to do that, because it comes down to local government funding and choices councils have to make.
Okay, if I can ask you, it's a related question, but on a specific issue, and I would ask this of Aberdeenshire colleagues as well, but they're not able to be here. There's something around large infrastructure projects that are seen to be needed. I'm talking about some of the SSEN work on grid upgrading and infrastructure upgrading. How is it that, given that the imperative goes beyond your remit, goes beyond Scottish Government remit, it's a UK-wide imperative. How do we make sure that, or how can you make sure that communities that are directly affected, particularly in rural areas, actually have their voices heard in a meaningful way?
So through the standard planning consultation process, all those upgrades will be consulted on, and anybody can put a representation into the energy consents unit. So I suppose from the formal process, communities can have their say. I know SSEN were recently consulting on potential for community benefit from grid infrastructure upgrade and substations, which was something UK government had been consulting on earlier in the year. I think I've still to produce findings from that. When you look at MPF4 and policy 11 in MPF4, 11C says that we should be maximising economic impact from all energy developments, and that includes grid infrastructure and substations. But at the moment, that policy doesn't have any guidance behind it, so local authorities can't suggest conditions around meeting socioeconomic benefits, and particularly local socioeconomic benefits. So I think that's an area where we could improve. If we had specific guidance on policy 11C, I think that brings it more into formal process.
Is there something in that space that Moray Council could determine for yourselves, given that you are probably better placed to understand that what happens in your communities than an external agency coming in from outside would be?
I think not just Moray Council, but the community themselves can do that. But what we're lacking at the moment is the powers to make it happen.
So it comes back to the decision-making power. Okay, I suppose I'm interested in exploring questions of accountability as well. And local authority folk may want to come in on this, but I'll come to Alistair and Alison on this. How is it that, how would you like to see questions around community empowerment and the accountability for decisions being made, whether those are made by local government, whether those are made by Scottish government, whether those are made by community councils, at whatever level they are made, how would you like to see accountability embedded in our understanding of those decision-making processes?
That's a very interesting one, and we should say we're looking forward to the Community Empowerment Act review.
Good answer.
I think there's a big thing about communities being asked constantly about things, but never feeling that they've actually been listened to. That's communities of place and communities of people. Because, and that involves the third sector as well, because people do feel that when you are consulted, there's a predetermined outcome. And it's very, very rare for the outcome to be changed from what a community's feedback has been after the fact of a development or something's been presented. I'd be happy to be corrected on that, but I would think it is a very, very small percentage where that happens. And so that gives people in communities it becomes a slog to take part in consultations. It becomes a slog to take part in decision-making processes at any level. It would be nice to have very, very local democracy. And I should declare I'm a community councillor. But that's maybe not the right model. And I know that we're all looking at this at the moment. But I think there does need to be a change, because there is a local authorities and communities do work together, but there is a lot of there is a disconnect, especially when you're talking about big areas in Moray and Aberdeenshire, where villages and towns have their own very distinct identity in the way that they do things, and that doesn't necessarily always reflect the way that things are done on a more regional basis.
Okay. And Alison, do you want to come in on?
Yeah, there is a power imbalance, and we have to then correct that power imbalance, otherwise there's not going to be the communities being listened to. So for instance, I completely agree with Alistair and what he was saying about localisation. It seems that the more local we make decision making, the more accountability there actually is. For instance, and also there's an awful lot of consultations about the same things, and I know that our members are getting quite weary of putting the same information, the same kind of consultations, and never understanding where it's going. So really, if you're going to put something information out, you need to then understand what's happened with that information. So from accountability perspective, what I'd like to see is if you put in you know, what you think, that you then get a response saying how that's been taken forward or not taken forward and why that is the case. So for instance, the National Planning Framework for a number of our community groups did put in consultation responses. That seemed like in the first iteration, that's a lot of what the third sector and community had put forward was going through. And then we have the corporate interest coming in, and actually the thing that goes forward looks very different. And really, from that whole thing, where do communities actually have power? Local place-based bans are just, you know, we can look at them, but the communities have no actual power to make decisions on where they're at. Where you have no actual power, then you get disconnected and disenfranchised. So really, there has to be that kind of real accountability coming through. You know, you said we did kind of thing. But also, what is the outcome when nothing does happen? Because in our current democratic system, there really isn't any real accountability, because we haven't got a real democracy in that sense. So I think you have to make it more democratic on the ground and follow that through with different systems to the top.
Thanks. Can I just unpick that a little bit more? And I suppose maybe think about the consequences of if and when this goes wrong. Do you see in the membership that you have, in the conversations you have with different communities, is there trust in the just transition agenda?
No, there really isn't. There's a hope and desire, but there's not a trust. Let's put it this way. The Just Transition Fund was kind of created very quickly. It got created off the back of, I think, to some extent, some Ian Wood's kind of conversations, etc. When we were engaged at the start, there was this expectation that there would be resourcing money for communities to be able to access the main part of the fund. We had 7 applications from NESCAM members going into that main bit of the fund. It took a lot of capacity for us to be able to support those and for communities to actually do that. They were up against organisations with huge resources and an understanding, and it is quite complicated putting in funding applications. So none of those were successful apart from NESCAM Hubs one, which was actually not done from the main bit of the fund, but from the resourcing money. So the understanding was that then NESCAM would get money to actually help communities build the capacity to enable them to bid into the next bit of the fund the next year. When that came about, because in the first year it was capital, there's multi-year bids put in by bigger organisations, they swept up the capital aspect of the Just Transition Fund for year two, leaving only financial instruments, which were completely inaccessible for community groups and charities to a large extent. The other little bit of money went to the energy transition zone to then put into pre-existing oil and gas companies as opposed to any new innovations. So in effect, community groups are unable to access the main chunk of the Just Transition Fund. So
there's quite a lot of work then, I suppose, that we and partners probably in local government as well need to do to build, I was going to say rebuild trust, but that implies it was there to begin with, but to build that trust. Are there particular things that you think we need to be focused on as we do that? Or does it come back to what you were saying earlier around we need to invest in people, in time, in capacity?
I think, so the kind of Just Transition Communities projects that we're doing, what we see is when you start co-creating plans with communities, with other actors, and then communities are responsible for creating those plans and passionate about where they live and really have a good idea of what needs to occur. Whenever you have this conversation, you don't need to call them Just Transition. In fact, you shouldn't. Just where would you like to see your community going? They will end up being Just Transition plans. And if you then resource them properly, so give capacity building, skill development for those people involved, commission within the community, so your community wealth building, and really then have a stakeholder group from local authority, business, community members, like they have done in some parts of Scotland already, then you get that building up, and then you have a plan, and then you finance that plan. And if you finance that plan, you will get the results that you want. And then you've got to keep on redoing that.
Thanks. Can I have one more question on planning?
I'll come back to you on planning. What I'm going to do is let Murdo Fraser in, as he has questions on the fund.
Makes sense.
And I'll come back to you, Maggie,
yep.
Then.
Thank you.
Sorry.
I've got a couple of questions around this, and maybe seeing as you raised it, then work our way along. I'll ask both questions together because they overlap. First is a very general question, which is, to what extent do you think the Just Transition Fund is being used effectively? And what could be done to make it more effective? And secondly, and slightly more specific, I was looking at some parliamentary answers my colleague Liam Kerr got just last week about the Just Transition Fund in year one of the £20 million available for 22-23, £10 million of capital grant allocation spent, £0.5 million financial transactions were allocated to Social Investment Scotland's Social Enterprise Just Transition Fund, and the balance of 9.5 million financial transactions were unallocated. For 23-24, the fund's entire financial transaction allocation of 25 million has been allocated to the Scottish National Investment Bank. And in our informal session this morning, we heard from some of the stakeholders concerns about the Scottish National Investment Bank role and how effective that was in liaising with local communities. So my second question is, do you think it's right that Scottish National Investment Bank are in charge of this money, and how effectively are they engaging with you?
So I think it's really difficult to actually measure the impact of the first year, because we haven't had any real communication about what has happened out of the first year funding. So what has happened to the money that's given out is not clear. What I will say, I think it's a very scattergun approach, and really you would never in a business start doing something without a plan of where you want to get to. So if you don't know where you want to get to, then how can you measure effectiveness? We don't have a vision for the actual fund, even though I did discuss that at the time, and it was said that we were going to have a regional vision for the Just Transition Plan, and there would be local stakeholders to create that. That didn't occur in year one, hasn't occurred yet. So I think giving money willy-nilly doesn't really produce an effect. You need to actually be thinking about why you're doing it, for what reason, to get to what outcome. So I think that's really important. I think that, you know, ineffective for communities because they only can get to access like very small percentage of that funds. With a Scottish National Bank, I don't know enough to really comment too much. What I will say is though that having financial instruments will not be effective for communities and third sector and for SMEs, you know, because it's only really for the big boys and girls that can really be able to do financial transactions. So giving it all to that is by effect denying entry to the fund or access to the fund for those who haven't got the financial resources to enable that to occur. It's always about horse trading. And really what I think we need to think about is, why do we have the Just Transition Fund? What do we want from it? And then really put the right financing into that It's not just about the amount, it's actually how it's allocated. Is it revenue? Is it capital? Is it financial instruments? And recognise who you're excluding by your kind of choices.
Alistair.
I also can't comment on the Scottish National Investment Bank. I don't know enough about it. But the effectiveness of the fund was the first part of your question, and what Alison said about having that vision of what the fund is trying to achieve would be important. And the information that you had this morning on my colleague Dan's presentation, which will be sent, showed the type of projects that have been successful in receiving money from the participatory budgeting part of the Just Transition Fund, which we work with NISCAN and other partners on. The number of projects around business and the economy were much lower than those projects about the environment and community and place. But that's because those are the things that communities have the skills and the capacity to deliver at the moment. We, as TSIs, we don't have the resources to help communities set up new businesses to change the economic outlook of their place. The fund as well is a very short time period in which to spend it, so those naturally are the types of projects that you can deliver in that short space of time as well. You can do things, you can build something within your community, or you can plant things within your community very quickly within a short space of time, but you can't develop a new business with just capital funding in 3 or 4 months.
Just before I bring the others in, Alistair, just to follow up something that came up in the session this morning. That having the funding restricted to capital funding was a barrier to many groups, and it would be better if it was also available for revenue funding. Is that something you agree with?
Yes, I think all the TSIs would support that. The three in the northeast would support that. It's all very well having the money to buy equipment, but if you can't pay someone to use it, or you can't get staff to run a place, then you fail before you've started. There's also the long-term ability to maintain a project then if you'd have no revenue funding. Because, I mean, the third sector, it's quite clear we need more fair funding, more funding that's longer term, more funding that's flexible, more funding that's easy to apply for, and more which is easy to report on as well and evaluate your outcomes on as well. So yeah, there's a few.
Apologies, obviously having microphone problems. Thank you. Stuart, maybe you go back to my original questions, if you don't mind. Yeah.
In terms of the first round and its efficiency, so in terms of the projects themselves, too early to say. What I would comment on is probably the process around how we got to those projects. It wasn't very clear what the fund was seeking to achieve. There was a huge breadth in applications that came forward. From an assessment point of view, I think that makes it really challenging for Scottish Government officials without really knowing what the fund is intended to do and the fact that it covers so many areas. The other thing that we felt about it was that there's a duplication there in terms of some of the other existing funds that the Scottish Government has. It's kind of, what do you want this fund to do that can't already be funded, I think is perhaps that question. The other parts around that, I think, where I would also add, we said in our consultation response that local authorities and other local stakeholders are well placed to support the Scottish Government in the assessment of those applications. We do have a number of local and regional initiatives that are ongoing, and I think where we could provide some input that would be helpful for Scottish Government colleagues is to understand what's already happening locally and regionally, and to make sure that there's complementarity rather than duplication within these ideas. In terms of the allocation of funding to SNIB, I'm not 100% sure if that is intended to be for the remainder of the programme or if it was just an initial allocation. What we struggled to understand there, though, was that in terms of the participatory budgeting piece, it's kind of been considered around £1 million per year. The allocation that we're seeing going through SNIB is significantly higher. I haven't seen evidence of why that figure, I guess, is probably the question that we're asking. And I think the point that Alison stressed earlier is around the idea of a plan. What do we want to achieve with this fund and how will we achieve it? It seems to me that if you decide an allocation of £1 million a year, primarily for the third sector through a participatory budgeting route, is sufficient to then allocate £25 million roughly per year through SNIB seems like a very different scale. And I think something that Alison and both Alistair have said is that the sort of investment that you'll see through SNIB is not really something that's likely to allow access through community groups and or the third sector in general. So I think there's elements of the fund that require a bit of clarification. And I think if that could be achieved before future rounds are called, I think that would really help stakeholders, likes of, you know, who you have on the panel today, to support other groups to bring forward proposals that have a really strong local impact, as well as supporting the intended outcomes of a just transition in terms of the Scottish Government's policy direction.
Okay, thank you. And Jim?
Yeah, so I think in terms of effect, I'd agree with my colleagues that capacity funding, particularly for your community groups, is key. Because without that capacity funding, they really can't even develop or build a project to a bid stage, never mind have the confidence of taking that forward if they're successful with it. But you may find this strange, but the same applies to local authorities. In Moray, we have quite a small team for economic development. We deliver as much as we can with the funding available, but when we have funding like Just Transition Fund that comes along at reasonably short notice to pull bids together, that really impacts on capacity. So capacity funding and that long-term plan or knowledge of what's coming over the next 5 years can make a real difference to the quality of bids and projects that you'll get coming forward. I think in the first round, all our bids were feasibility projects, really looking at putting the strategy or the strategic elements in place for future bids for it. And I suppose similar to UHI Moray with their green skills gap, they were looking at, well, let's do the work, find the evidence base and really look where do we need to intervene to make a difference in future rounds. So I think that's where the first round went on. SNIB itself, they've certainly been in contact with the council. I'm not aware of them being in contact with community groups, but that doesn't mean to say they haven't been. As others have said, I think it's a very difficult fund for communities to get involved in. And I'm not sure how much value it added, because I believe there was similar funding already available through SNIB that people could access for that purpose.
Okay, thanks for that. I mean, just to follow up with both of you from local authority perspectives, I mean, I can understand, I mean, going back to the point Alison made earlier about, I think the term you used, that SNIB funding is for the big boys and girls. So maybe that is the intention, but perhaps we need some more clarity from SNIB around that. But what engagement have both local authorities had with SNIB about how you point people in their direction and access funding?
In terms of Aberdeen City Council, there may have been engagement. It's certainly not with myself, so I couldn't comment on sort of giving you a specific no, they haven't been in touch. I assume they have, but certainly in the role that I'm in, I would anticipate that if there were conversations being had with funding bodies, I probably ought to be aware of that, and so far I'm not. We had the announcement that the funding was to be sort of rerouted through SNIB, and like Jim said, you know, there were funds already available within SNIB for a very similar purpose. I can see a degree of sense in making use of SNIB because it does that type of transactions already. I think the question I have around the involvement of SNIB is perhaps where the figure came from as to how much should go in there and if there's any evidence of demand for that. But for the type of funding that they would offer, I don't disagree with making use of them.
Yes, so SNIB did contact myself within the council, had a conversation around what the fund could do and how they would operate. So we have the contact there. It's really identifying then what types of projects would be suitable for bidding into that and which organisations may be suitable for doing it.
And have they given you guidance around that last point?
So they haven't given us guidance around that last point.
They haven't?
No, right, okay. There's been nothing come out directly to me on that.
Okay, all right, thank you.
OK,
Okay, thank you. I'm going to bring Gordon MacDonald in, as it's again on the fund. So.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. Good afternoon, panel. We've touched upon already participatory budgeting. And I was just wanting to ask, I was interested in a comment you made, Jim, earlier on, where you said we already do extensive engagement with the community, and you gave a long number of examples. So the £1 million that's gone into participatory budgeting, what impact has that had?
In terms of participatory budgeting, it's been led by TSI Murray. Mm-hmm. Very much welcome both by TSI Murray as an organisation in the impact they can then have across communities and their engagement with communities. But also the communities themselves, it is an opportunity. It's an opportunity not just for the communities and their individual projects, but to share ideas across communities as well. So I think it's a very useful mechanism. It's a mechanism that the communities themselves are quite used to now, in that there's been several different funding mechanisms over the years that have been delivered that way through TSI Murray and Money for Murray. So it's well recognised, very supported by community and very welcomed by communities as a way of accessing funding.
Okay, and how do you think over the 10-year period that the Just Transition Fund will be in place, would you be supportive of that element of the fund increasing?
Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay. Alistair, I was wanting to ask you, the voting of projects, etc., is that the most effective way to allocate funds?
It's certainly the most effective way to make sure communities feel that they've had their say. Mm-hmm. And to enliven and animate communities around their own particular project and get more people involved and get that level of engagement at a community level. I would say it's probably better than people sitting in a closed room deciding. Okay. Certainly more open and transparent. But we would also take as much money from the fund to give out that way as we could get our hands on.
And Alison, this morning, the presentation you gave, you highlighted being an increase in participation from year one to year two. I think it was 62%, if I picked up the number correctly.
Dan did say that, yeah.
Yeah.
I think, obviously, so Money for Murray and TSI Murray have been doing participatory budgeting for a long time in Murray. So the understanding of the communities is much more understanding about A, what Just Transition is, and B, what participatory budgeting is. Obviously, it's quite a new concept here. The council has done it, but only in specific communities. So it has to be more familiarisation. As the communities in the region get more aware of it, then you get more buy-in. But obviously, as we as organisations supporting it get more understanding of how we can do it better, that also increases. So, you know, giving that support, the capacity building to groups to really get the publicity going to ensure that we have the right structure and criteria, that all makes a difference. It has had an impact on communities. It is good. As you heard this morning, there was a huge amount of projects and different kinds of community projects. And I do think that's really important that the variety is in the smaller projects more than the big amounts, because the big amounts will go to retrofitting and vehicles and stuff like that. But for communities to really get some funds, it's amazing what it can do. It has to go alongside revenue funding. We have had some revenue funding this year, but I think if we had the revenue funding as part of the actual amount that you bid for, that would make it a lot better. Should it purely be PB? I think the best way ahead for giving community projects money would be not just PB, but just straightforward funding as well. If we want to ensure that we are covering all bases, then that would be a good way. But as Alistair was saying, it really does help to really communicate Just Transitions more widely, which I think is beneficial. I think it's got multiple purposes, the Just Transition Participatory Budgeting Fund. It's developing climate literacy, enables us to go into community groups and really help them to recognise that the projects that they actually have are community climate action projects, to enable them to think wider and get different funding, but then put them onto the next step of really becoming more climate active in a way that suits them and their communities.
You know, it was great to see that 62% increase in people taking part, but when you looked at the age profile, under 25s were a very small proportion of the people that took part. So how are you going to improve the engagement process with under 25s?
So we wanted to build in Young Scot this year. We didn't have the time. And that's an issue that we have with this whole like one year. And because by the time we get it and then we do the criteria and we learn the lessons and we put things in place, there's very little time for us to actually run the fund. And then the groups get the money before then it goes out the door but to be spent by the 31st of March. You can imagine that it's very tight. So what happens is that then the time that we have is right over the summer, which is when the schools are out. So we can't access young people if we continue to have the same kind of timing constraints in a really effective way. So what we would like to do is work with our partners, MDEC and other partners, to go into schools and do more school work. And that we have the ability and the partners to be able to do that. And then also use Young Scot platform, which is very effective, much more engaging platform for young people, for the voting aspect too. So there are different ways and mechanisms that we can do it, but it does mean that we really need to not be doing that whole thing over the summer. It needs to be before that or after that. So we need to be very aware of the fact that community groups have got a lack of capacity over the summer too, because they're on summer holidays. So it needs to be engagement throughout the whole year. And if we weren't stuck to this whole one year of having to spend it by the 31st of March, then it'd be much more effective.
Okay. I've just got one final point, again, back to you, Jim. In the written submission from Moray Council, it said, projects funded which have a region-wide remit are perhaps finding it difficult to engage with areas such as Moray, with which they have no previous connections for delivery of services, meaning the benefit may be concentrated in Aberdeen. Are you able to elaborate on that?
Yeah, so I was referring a bit like Alison mentioned it earlier, that obviously very good bids came in from some of the organisations within Aberdeen, both the educational, but also some of the local agencies. They bid for region-wide projects, and although they touched base with us, I think because there's a lack of relationship there, it's a bit more difficult then for them to deliver region-wide because they are very Aberdeen.
How would you resolve that?
Has to be done through great communication. But I don't know the agencies, I don't know what capacity they have to do that within their bids.
Okay, thanks very much.
Okay, thank you. Maggie Chapman, do you wish to come in on planning and then I'll take Brian Whittle.
Thanks very much. Claire, I suppose Jim and Stuart, particularly coming back, what we've spoken about some of the issues that you know community groups have around the broader planning strategies, and you talked about the planning process and consultations and community engagement in that way. I'm just wondering whether you think there's actually more we can be doing to reach people who maybe can't or don't know how to engage, because a consultation is only as good as the framework that sets it up, but also as the responses it gets back. And if we're not reaching the right people, then we're going to miss folk in that. And I'm just wondering whether you can comment on that, thinking particularly about the spatial planning that we've got.
Yeah, so it's always a challenge. I think in Moray, certainly our engagement on planning master plans and local development plan process, we do involve the schools. So we're trying to get in there and reach as many young people, because ultimately that's what the local development plan is for. They're the ones that will ultimately benefit for it. So we do a lot of work with schools and trying to get in with them. We go to the communities themselves and have the usual sort of displays and workshops and drop-in sessions with communities. We also try and contact communities of interest, particularly around accessibility, etc., to try and get as much input as we can. But it's difficult. It's difficult to even, you can go to a community, but there'll always be individuals within that community that won't come to a drop-in session. And perhaps aren't involved in a community of interest. And that's difficult. I think we do a lot online nowadays as well and through social media. So we try and, or we do capture some of that information from perhaps people that wouldn't otherwise engage in a face-to-face session through social media.
Okay. And Stuart, a similar question to you. How can we make sure we do actually capture community voices, not just a few community voices?
I think the what Jim is describing in terms of the work that goes on happens in most local authorities. I think you do get a lot of feedback, and I think the part I would probably say that we need to be clearer on when we do engage is to actually understand what the questions we're asking. It's very easy to ask a whole range of broad questions and you get broad responses. I think sometimes we need to understand the subject matter better and ask much more direct questions, which give us a much more direct feedback that we can actually do something with. I think the other part in and around that is that probably as part of that designing of the consultation piece itself, before going out to consult with kind of communities as a whole, I think we probably need to engage a bit closer with stakeholders who are often closer to either the communities themselves or to certain sectors and so on, and actually engage with them as part of that design piece before we seek the views, so that we'll get a steer in terms of what those questions should look like, and so we avoid going out with these really general type questions which don't give us a real input back. And I think the point that Alistair made earlier, many communities, people and places may feel that they've kind of been a bit ignored. And I think part of that is because we're asking the wrong questions sometimes. We're being very generic and vague in those. And I think that's something that, if I think about the Just Transition piece we said earlier, there's a bit of a lack of a plan. And I mentioned about our concerns around expectation management. And that's the concern I have, is if we were to go out and engage on the Just Transition Fund, as it is, what does that do for expectations? Because we have no means by which to kind of combat that. And I know we have ideas about how we would like to see that look so that we could go out and have a positive engagement. But actually just now we're a bit in limbo of, if we create all this expectation and huge amounts of time, effort and money is spent on the capacity to try and pull together good funding applications, we know that from experience of round one, there's a reasonable expectation that they won't get through. We know that if the participatory budget element remains at around £1 million per year, if we create an expectation and support groups to develop more, many of them are going to be disappointed. And of course, the whole process then feels like, well, we told them and they didn't listen. So I think there's a piece that we probably need to do first, which is around that wider plan, and then engage.
And do you see this linking to other sort of regional strategic work like that happening within the regional economic partnerships, for instance? How do you see the sort of planning element specifically for the Just Transition? Have you had those kinds of conversations at the regional economic partnership level?
To some extent. I think often I feel like there's a lack of an understanding around the Just Transition Fund, which means that when we're talking at a regional economic partnership level about the regional economic strategy, somebody may say, could we seek support through the Just Transition Fund?
Yeah.
And you go, well, I'm not sure, maybe.
Okay.
And this whole piece then, again, around expectation management, there's an expectation we should be able to access it because it feels like it's a good fit with the fund. And so it's a real struggle. And I know some of our regional economic partners fed back through the consultation, I've viewed their responses.
Yeah.
And generally, I think the view across certainly Aberdeen, which is all I can talk for at the moment, is one of, there's a huge opportunity there, but what can we actually do? And if we don't define that well enough, then I feel really sorry for the officials at the Scottish Government who are going to be bombarded with a host of really good ideas, but unable to support all of them because we haven't got a clear definition on what the priority is.
Of course. For other members. I'll bring in Brian Whittle, who has questions on planning system, followed by Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Gavina. Good afternoon to the panel. Appreciate you being here. Discussions this morning, it was quite interesting how planning came up, and it was mentioned there was a sort of communities feel removed from decision making and actually disengaging, and the words of onshore wind came up and solar came up, and I just wonder what you consider that the current planning regulations are fit for purpose, especially around spatial planning and the presumption of planning, because you know, certainly I'm a South of Scotland MSP, and my bag's full of this. We said no, but the Scottish Government said yes. Why did you bother asking us type scenario? So I wonder, if I come to you, Alison, is that part of the problem?
A huge problem. And communities have really got no power in planning. The presumption needs to change from development to one against, except for when it is sustainable development. And communities need to have more of a say what goes in their community, but then it comes with responsibility. So not just a kind of not in our backyard approach, but that comes with power, comes with responsibility. So the local place-based plans are, in my view, quite ineffectual because they don't have any legal authority. And what happens also, and also I think that the local authorities themselves, you know, there's an awful lot of planning that would want to have say no more to kind of unsustainable development, but are not empowered to because the reporter will come back because the presumption for development, and they will reject the council's decision not to give permission to those developments. There's a lot that we could be doing in relation to giving planning permission that could really enable a just transition. There is some local authorities in England that have kind of guidance along this kind of basis of exactly what you can do. We really have to have a holistic approach in relation to active transport, health, growing space, like green byways and blue byways. So connectivity between communities. So in short, communities need more say. And if we bring them in a proper way, then the responsibility will come with that as well.
If I could just build on that a little bit, Alistair, if I played a bit of devil's advocate here, you would suggest that many communities would say, yes, we do think that it's really important that for the transition that we have onshore wind and we have solar, but I don't want it over there. So how do we cross that boundary of bringing the communities with us? To make sure that they're properly recompensed for any, you know, development around about them.
So I'll try and, I suppose it's not really my place as representing TSIs to comment on planning per se, but what I would say is that communities who are successful in getting a really meaningful community benefit from a development such as a wind farm are communities who are already upskilled and have the structures in place to be able to do that. So it is about, again, capacity building in communities to be able to take advantage of what is available, but also to have those skills to oppose something that you don't want, because those skills don't exist everywhere as well. So that would be from a community group perspective. I'd say that there are places that have very knowledgeable people, very well-resourced people who are able to mount campaigns for or against certain developments, but that's not everywhere. And again, say, taking a community benefit from a wind farm, there are places that have very good structures that are making great benefits throughout Aberdeenshire and Moray as well. And perhaps not so much in this city, no, no onshore wind in the city. Those skills are already there. What we don't have is a way of really empowering communities to get those skills, to learn those skills, to be able to do those things.
Mm. I suppose from a council perspective, does the planning frustrate you any?
I think you have a planning system that I think if you look over the last 10 years, it never stops getting reviewed for something. Third party right of appeal is always part of that review. It never makes it into the final version because of the difficulties of having a third party right of appeal effectively delaying development in the long term. So I think communities have to engage at the local development plan evidence stage, which is what we're doing in Moray just now. They really have to influence what goes into the policy, and as with MPF4, they have to influence that. I think once you have those policies there, it's very difficult for communities to influence something that they perhaps don't like if actually planning policy supports it. And with MPF4 now, with renewable energy, and quite rightly, because we need to tackle climate change, you have a policy document that is exceptionally supportive of renewable energy developments, including onshore wind. In policy 11, you have a policy there that recognises that there will be significant, or some types of renewable energy give significant landscape and visual impact, but can still be acceptable with that. Now, there's a balance in there, in that it does say we will only support these where we maximise economic impact, and where there's local community, local and community socio-economic benefit. But that's the bit I referred to last time. At the moment, there's a lack of guidance there. If members wish, they could go and look at the most recent reporters' decisions on those, and you'll see that for that policy 11C, they effectively are saying we can't make a decision on this because of the lack of guidance. So the policy is delivering renewable energy, but communities, particularly in rural areas, are missing out on the socio-economic benefit because it's not being maximised. And I think that's a real issue that needs to be addressed.
I'll leave it there, Convener.
Thank you. Kevin Stewart, do you wish to come in?
Thank you very much, Convener. And it's great to be in the wonderful northeast of Scotland in this great city of Aberdeen. And last night I was boring some colleagues to death around about the visionary document that was the Aberdeen 1952 local plan. And it was a visionary document, and we've talked about vision here today. And in some regards, from my perspective, that vision should be from the grassroots up rather than from government down. So we've heard quite a lot today about MPF4, for which I'm partly responsible. We've heard a lot about local development plans. We've had some touching on local place plans, but not very much. But one of the great things that came from this city and was very prevalent in the Northeast, but has disappeared, was planning for real. And that was community planning as well as spatial planning. Now, the local place plans were supposed to bring community planning and spatial planning together, which should lead to much greater understanding for communities of what the ambition is and what their vision is for their communities. So my initial question is for Jim and Stuart, and I recognise that there's been the COVID years and the rest of it, but what have your local authorities done in terms of trying to help communities formulate local place plans? And has community planning been linked with that to get the best possible solution and the vision of those communities? Jim first, please.
Yeah, thanks for the question, a good question, in terms of local place plans. So as an authority, we did planning for real with a number of communities, and you're right, it wasn't just spatial planning that was looked at. In fact, I'd say the majority of issues that communities wanted to be dealt with weren't planning issues. They were much more functional in terms of how the town worked and potholes and parks and different things they wanted to see. In terms of local place plans, the stage we're at in local development plan, where we have to produce the next local development plan by 2027. So we've gone out to communities with a call for those that are interested in local place plans. We've had quite a number of responses from different places that are looking at that. And have noted their interest in it, and then through the process of developing the local development plan, we'll engage with those communities and see what we can do to guide them and help them with the production of that plan. And I think that's, at the moment, it's only once those local place plans are produced that we can then take account of them to build them into local development plan.
So you've said that there's a look-see at that as you build the LDP. And that's fair enough in some regards. What I would be interested in knowing is those poorer communities, what are you doing to help them get the expertise to build those local place pads? But you missed out the element of planning for real, the community planning aspect of this. In terms of the formulation of local place plans, are you, as an authority, bringing together the community planning aspect of planning for real in order to get this right, not just for the LDP, but to create the vision for the future for individual communities across Murray?
Yeah, so in terms of local place plans, it's not just the planners that are engaging with the community on that. We are working closely with our community support unit, and it's our community support unit that work across community planning and work with communities. They effectively led most of the planning for real work, so we're doing a similar thing with the local place plans in how we approach it.
Okay, so if I come back to communities in Murray, which I quite often do, and say to folk, how did that go in terms of that linkage between community planning and spatial planning? Did it work for Bucky or Falkirkburghs or Forrest or wherever it may be? They'll be able to turn around to me and say, yeah, Murray did it right.
So because unless community planning starts considering place, and I don't mean just local place plans, mm-hmm. but unless the partners around community planning really start looking at place, not just in relation to spatial planning, but service delivery, then how are we all going to work collaboratively, both in terms of where we invest, but also where we have to cut services? That has to be done in a collaborative way across partners if we're going to have sustainable places in the future.
Stuart, the Aberdeen perspective.
Unfortunately, I'd have to consult with colleagues in strategic place planning. It's not an area of my work.
Okay, it would be interesting to hear from planning colleagues, community planning and spatial planning colleagues in Aberdeen around about that. I see Alison wanting to come in, convener.
Actually, NESCOM's been helping both in Aberdeen City and Aberdeenshire to try and do exactly that. So I said that we did community assemblies in Tillydrone, Woodside, Linksfield and Torrey. And so we've been working with the community planning and that to really ensure that those are pushed into the LOIP and also the, what's it called, priority neighbourhood planning as well. And they also, the work we've been doing, can form the basis of local place-based planning. And that is going into a year two of the communities project in Aberdeenshire. We're working with local authority colleagues in Inverurie, in different local authority areas within Aberdeenshire, to ensure that the plans that we're creating in these deliberative democratic processes actually are the local place-based plans, and they bring in the community planning as well.
So probably my next question was for you and for Alistair, because, you know, very definitely this morning we heard from folks from across the northeast of Scotland who very definitely had a vision for their places. Mm-hmm. Absolutely no doubt about that. Do you think that local authorities, Scottish Government, other public bodies, do you think that they are listening to the degree that they should around about that vision? And would you share my view that it should be that bottom-up vision rather than a top-down vision that makes sure that we get this just transition absolutely right? Alison, please.
Yeah, I mean, and to come just briefly answer your question, the other question. Unfortunately, what's happening is a lot, I think that in Aberdeen City, a lot of it's going on to community councils who haven't got the capacity to be able to do local place-based plans. So there needs to be the capacity given to communities to create those plans. They're really labour-intensive, and the skills as well to develop them. But yeah, no, I totally agree, Kevin, with the fact that it needs to be bottom-up, because when you take a co-creation approach, you get the right plan. So you get all the kind of knots pulled apart at the very beginning, and then you're all on the same wavelength going through. So whereas it can take some time to create a co-creational plan, it goes much faster after that point. So if you go into community and you just say, right, we're going to put in segregated bike paths along these roads, this road, and this road, just an example, it won't work as well as you go in and say, okay, would you like this, and where should we put them? Where will you use them? And then you get the right things, and you don't get the money wasted. So definitely that's the case. What happens, though, at the moment is that a lot of people think it wastes time to go in and do co-creation. They haven't got the time. They want to do it fast as possible. And they don't trust the community. And that's what we're getting. So then you get misspent money in things that don't work.
So from a personal point of view, I've found that the best policy and decision making has been when you've listened to the voices of lived experience as you're formulating the policy. And that's basically what you're arguing for. Alistair, do you share that view? I'm sure you do, but let's hear from you on that front.
Yeah, absolutely. It is a collaborative approach that's needed. But what I would say is, again, is that parity of esteem, as they say, between the third sector and other partners isn't always there. The experts of lived experience, people who actually know what's going on, are not always taken seriously, their opinions, not always given the same weight, and that is an issue. What I would say about local place plans, particularly though, is if they were really designed to implement the wishes of communities, then they would have some statutory weight to them, which they don't.
I think there doesn't necessarily need to be statutory weight, but there has to be parameters that are set by all sites. And I think communities understand that. They understood that during planning for Real here many, many moons ago. They realised that you can have a swimming pool in three adjacent streets, for example, and folk realised that, you know, you're going to need X amount of housing to make sure that the school is going to continue to have the role it has. So I think that none of this is insurmountable. My final point, convener, is around about communication, because we heard from a lot of people this morning around about various things, and they had questions about aspects of how the entire Just Transition Fund was working, because it had never been explained to them the reasoning for certain things happening. Do you think that communication needs to be improved? And this can be yes or no, basically, from Jim.
Yeah. Yes, I'd say so. I think communication at the beginning, before the first round, was very good over that short period of time to pull things together. It's been very quiet since, so I think it can.
Sure.
Echo what Jim says, and I think part of that communication, if we could get more than a year-by-year approach, that would be hugely beneficial.
Alistair?
Yeah, it's very rushed, and that's the main issue that we're coming.
Alison?
Yes, but there is a severe lack of capacity within the climate change division team. There's not enough people there to do it.
Okay. Just one point, and I could probably spend hours on this, to be honest with you, and still not make a lot of sense. But financial transactions are things that confuse quite a lot of folk, and I think, convener, we maybe need to look at the FTs a little bit more closely, because I seem to have the impression from the community groups that it would be almost impossible for them to access FT money. However, convener, it has been done previously in the form of charitable bonds, and that's maybe something that we would maybe want to explore, charitable bonds for housing, that was. And I just wonder, in terms of the explanation around about this, has the information that you had been helpful, or has it really not helped at all and been a hindrance in terms of FT usage?
I think FT is a very difficult concept to put across to people. I don't think charitable bonds would work for community groups. They might work for bigger charities. I think the only thing that will work for community groups is just funding and revenue and capital combined.
Thank you. Alistair?
Yeah, I would agree. You would need the capacity within the community groups to be able to handle these things. But yes, it just needs to be money, but it needs to be longer term, or it needs to be in a more sustainable, fairer way.
And I suppose that would be very difficult for community groups to handle when they're all voluntary in the main.
Exactly.
Yeah. Grant, thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Just before I move to Brian Whittle, just on the issue of planning, and Jim, you kind of answered the first question around the planning system, whether it is enabling a just transition. We do have to achieve our climate targets at pace. Does the planning system, the current one we're working with, do you think it recognises that, or is it presenting difficulties or barriers to actually getting the changes done at a pace that we need to see?
So I think MPF4 as a document has absolutely created that ambition around getting it done, both from climate change and biodiversity, a very positive message coming out of MPF4. I think at the moment it lacks some of the guidance that would allow planning authorities to really enforce that ambition and deliver on that ambition. I think there's certain policies where there's uncertainty, both from developers and planning authorities in terms of what does that mean. And it's early days for MPF4, but I think if we don't get the guidance in place, we'll miss out on opportunities. Community wealth building policy within MPF4, I think it's fantastic to see it in MPF4, but it lacks any bite. It simply says if it's got community wealth building, we'll support it, but it doesn't say what we'll do if it doesn't have community wealth building. So those elements could improve, but as a document, it certainly clearly sets the ambition and pace that's been looking for.
Thank you. Brian, did you have a couple other questions you wanted to?
Yeah, thank you. I'll be brief, Convener, given our time. I wanted to briefly just have a wee look at the relationship between UK and Scottish Government policy. And you may be aware that they sometimes disagree on the odd occasion. Do you think that the UK Government policy provide enough clarity and certainty around that transition to net zero? I'll come to you, Stuart, if I could.
That's quite the question. I think, not deliberately sitting on the fence here, but I think what I would say to some extent is just, I think both governments to some extent, we find it difficult to interpret the difference between a just transition and an energy transition. We have so many transitions that to fully understand what one thing is over another is really difficult. Within the funding landscape as well, we see a lot of use of terminology, which again may suggest energy transition, but actually the intent may be just transition. So I think when we look at that as a local authority, we're fortunate to some extent we have capacity, knowledge and resource and experience of these things to pick that up. But I do suspect that smaller organisations will struggle to recognise the difference. And again, it's making these things as efficient as possible. In my current role, I engage regularly with Scottish and UK government officials jointly, and that's been a really good positive experience, because what we find is that they're able to understand what the challenges we face are in terms of delivering policies which in many cases are intended to deliver similar things but actually are worded differently, which means that there's a potential for clash in there. So do I think that they're both on the same page? Possibly not, but I don't think they're a million miles apart.
So if you agree with that, Jim, what would your asks be for each government?
So yeah, I do agree with that. In terms of the ask, I think Scottish Government set out the ambition clearer around just transition. UK Government very much recognise the challenge of energy infrastructure and the impact of the energy infrastructure on the regions that host it, hence their consultation earlier in the year around community benefit. I think I'm not sure a voluntary community benefit system is necessarily what we need. Are we going to deliver a just transition with a purely voluntary system? I think that's a question I'd ask, and whether actually through things like MPF4 and Policy 11, is that something that should be addressed through planning?
Yeah, if I just finally, just if we add in all layers of government, do you think there's enough policy coherence between all those layers to allow you to develop a strategic plan? Stuart? Stop hiding.
I think we have lots of policy, and increasingly sometimes what we find is that when developing new policy, there's a need to take account of a lot of existing policy. The difficulty in doing that is that if that existing policy are to be changed in any way, shape or form, it has an impact on the new policy, and from a wider kind of community point of view, it's too much. You know, what are we trying to do? What's the latest policy? And we see things in funding applications, strategic fit. Where do you want to start? You know, you could link it to almost any strategy or policy. I think what would be really useful to know is, if we were talking about a just transition fund, what is the key underpinning policy? And that's a relatively defined scope. At the moment, I think the challenge we have is lots of policy, lots of targets, lots of objectives. Those can and are routinely reviewed and amended and so on. And trying to get that longer term focus that we all spoke about from the funding perspective is so difficult when there is a lot of emerging and, I don't know if adapting is the right word here, but you know, policy and strategy. I think local authorities, we set out a clear vision that takes us up to 2045. Those are visions. How we deal in terms of the kind of the more regular and localised policy is harder, because the changes that we see in terms of specific to here, that transition from sort of oil and gas towards net zero, there's a huge amount of things that can happen at pace. So within the context of a long-term strategy, we need to be able to take account of that. What challenges us is obviously national governments then developing national policies and frameworks, and we have to ensure that our long-term strategies still fit into those. And that's all fine, we can probably just about do it. But from a community perspective, that idea of how we get people engaged and not disengaged, if there's too many policies, procedures, it's just such a confusing message to put out there. And you mentioned the piece around that kind of that communications. It would be fantastic if we could talk about just transition in a single message that captured the national policy and strategy side, as well as regional, local, community levels. And I think what we want to see is the ideas coming from the communities, understanding what are those key policy and strategy drivers that they're looking to support implementation of.
I'll leave it there.
Okay, thank you. John Mason, do you wish to ask any questions?
I mean, we've covered quite a lot of ground, and some of the issues have been touched on already, but we have focused quite a lot on the communities and how they can feed in. And I think some of the input from the local authorities, some of the written input, has been about how maybe the councils, three in this case, I think, could be more in control of the whole fund rather than central government. And we got some suggestion this morning that some of the central government rules, you know, are making it very difficult to put it into practice. I mean, should it have been, or should it now be, the whole fund more under the control of the local authorities? Mr. Grant.
That's a good question. Certainly local authorities are more than capable, and as three local authorities, I think one of the good things with the announcement of the Just Transition Fund is it brought the three local authorities together in that partnership and working together much more actively than previously we do. Murray sits with Highlands and Islands Regional Economic Partnership. So although we've always had good relationships, we've only ever come together when it makes sense to come together. So I think from that point of view, yes, the local authorities could do that. Should the local authorities be the ones in control? I'm not sure I would go that far. I think there's local authorities, there's communities, there's the business group, and it's maybe looking at, well, how do you bring that together as a board regionally to have more say and more involvement rather than just local authorities?
I mean, I think we've got the wrong, yes. And one of the specific things that came up this morning, it's been referred to already today, is this kind of a one-year window that you have to have consultation, you have to make decisions, and then you have to spend the money all within a year. And of course, local authorities also, to some extent, have that problem, because I know they're always complaining about they want multi-year funding. But do you think if the local authorities were running it with this fund for 10 years, you'd be better able to deal with that and give community groups more of a spread of time? Mr. Buse, if you want.
Thank you. Yes, is the short answer. I think, just to pick up on your original question, I think we probably want to make a distinction here that we're not necessarily suggesting local authorities have control over the fund, but rather local authorities could be used as a means to administer the fund. I'm mindful that colleagues within the Scottish Government are being asked to take a lot of decisions that have a local impact without necessarily having the local knowledge that local stakeholders would have. I think Jim's suggestion of potentially creating a board or something similar could be something worth exploring, because one of the conversations that we've had recently is that where the third sector have been asked to administer the participatory budget, and I know that early November they've announced the successful projects. Those projects have until the end of March to spend that money, and as far as I understood it, the third sector bodies haven't actually received the funding from the Scottish Government to be able to pay it out. One of the things that a local authority can do if we have a longer term agreement with the government is we might be able to support in trying to accelerate some of those processes. We administer shared prosperity funds on behalf of the UK government, place-based investment funds on behalf of the Scottish government, and we regularly take calls for applications throughout the year. And the flexibility that we can offer to do that while still reporting back to the Scottish government on a annual basis within the financial year can be achieved. So that may be a way of trying to address some of the concerns around the kind of the single year rush, if you like, to get projects in, out for consultation, approved and spent within a relatively short period of time.
I mean, if I just stick with the two local authorities at the moment, I'll come back to yourselves and let you comment afterwards. But do the local authorities have a capacity for taking on more of the kind of running of this? Because I know you're all strapped as well, either of you.
Challenging.
Very challenging given local government finance as it is, and certainly where Moray Council is at the moment. I think there'd need to be capacity funding there to enable some of that to happen.
Yes.
And just to echo that, I think the level of capacity funding there is probably not much different than the resource that the Scottish Government already has to put into this. I think the difference is the fund is a bit closer to where it's intended to have that impact. Ultimately, whether it's one, two, three local authorities, whoever it is that could have responsibility, they will be accountable back to the Scottish Government. So I think that could be achieved.
Okay. And just another point for the two of you. I mean, I think it was Aberdeenshire Council, sorry, that had raised a point, and I realise they're not there today, so maybe, or maybe not, you can comment on this. But the idea that the Just Transition Fund should be aligned with other economic plans, such as the Regional Economic Strategy, and we've heard a bit about duplication, but I mean, are they aligned at the moment, or can they be better aligned, or is it a problem, or is it not a problem? Mr. Pearce, yes.
There is some alignment, not complete alignment, and I wouldn't expect the Just Transition Fund to fully align with the Regional Economic Strategy. I think the rationale in around that comment probably stems from a number of areas. There's pieces in the Regional Economic Strategy around innovation. There's also pieces in there around communities and culture. So again, there's scope for some alignment within there, but I think probably more what I would take from that comment is something I said earlier about, you know, we've been talking about community plans, locality plans, how do they fit? And when we start looking at all the different spheres of governance, it's quite a stretch to take something that's very localised and community-led and link it into a national policy. So I think if we're looking at something in around that regional level, they tend to have been developed with regional partners, and they're probably more suited to the kind of the plans that are in place across that regional level.
Mr. Grant?
Yeah, I'd agree, and I think that comment probably relates to some of the projects in the first round that were successful perhaps didn't align with regional plans for Aberdeenshire, particularly around transport links, etc. So I think more cognizance of the strategies and what an area is trying to achieve already when considering bids is something that should be looked at.
I mean, I think as people know, I'm a substitute in the committee, so I'm not quite as familiar with some of this as colleagues are. But coming in from outside, my feeling was that the idea of a Just Transition Fund should be quite kind of clear cut. It should be in a space that nothing else is. And yet stuff I've heard this morning, like, you know, well, in order to get the money quickly and spend it, we either plant trees or get an electric vehicle. And both of these, I would have thought, could have happened elsewhere. They didn't need a Just Transition Fund to make them happen. So is it just really, maybe I'm slightly cynical, is it just more money for things that we're already trying to do? Or is there a specific space for this fund?
So I think comes down to that definition of what is just transition. If I talk about Highlands and Islands Regional Economic Partnership, and you're looking across the difficulties for islands and certainly remote rural areas, it's the usual things that we've already or always done around population challenge, housing, transport links, skills, digital connectivity. They're the big issues facing lots of rural communities and urban centres as well, and the inequalities around that. So just transition can mean lots of things depending what your intervention you're looking for. I suppose from my point of view, it's where does the balance of investment go? So urban areas particularly can have overheated economies, etc. Equally, you've got rural areas with significant depopulation issues, where we can't get people in the hospitality sector, we can't get employees for the care sector. But if we concentrate all our investment in one place, that's not a just transition. So it's really looking at how do we address some of these issues around inequalities, both in urban areas and rural areas, to try and address that and give the just transition on it.
Okay, I realise that my questions are mainly to the local authorities. So, Mr. Ross or Ms. Stewart, I mean, do you have any thoughts about that? Should we have more of the decision-making power at the local authority level, or should we just forget both central government and local authorities and focus entirely on the communities?
No, I've always felt we need not just a just transition fund plan, but a regional plan which includes everybody in the region. And I really don't feel as if there should be a disconnect between all the different plans. And the regional economic strategy should also be a just transition strategy, and it should include communities and third sector and everyone involved in it. So it isn't just the usual industry or vested interests that are dictating the direction that our region is going in. And I feel that very strongly, and I feel that there should be a body which takes forward this plan, this vision into action plan, and then the accountability aspect of that. So then, you know, there's a reporting to that body, which is a regional body, which has got representatives from different areas within our society. And that the Just Transition Fund then would be linked into the plans that body, that the people come up with.
But perhaps led by the three local authorities?
Well, the thing is, though, you're going to have a lot of politics within that. There's a lot of already pre-existing vested interests, and I feel that sometimes, like, having it coming from out of region or out of that is a positive, so there could be newness, and it breaks up some of that. And I don't understand why it hasn't already been this huge collaboration on a regional vision for just transition anyway, and it comes down to the fact that there is politics involved. So I do wonder how effective that would be for real new ways of doing things and new ways of thinking. But I haven't given enough thought to any further on that.
Okay. Did you want to add anything, Mr. Ross?
I hadn't thought about it beforehand, but I kind of agree on that point of the fact that the funds come from the Scottish Government. That feels more neutral than perhaps it would be if it came from local authorities, although saying that the closer the money is to people, the better. So I'll need to have a think about that one.
Okay,
but we, from a third sector perspective, just say if we were involved in some regional plan, we would want an equal seat at the table. At the moment, we don't have an equal seat at the table in terms of economic strategy, any economic planning or anything like that. The third sector, despite its size, both economically and in terms of people and social impact, we don't have that status as an equal partner.
Though you're not actually elected, are you?
No.
Okay, I'll leave it at that, convener.
Thank you. That brings us to the end of this afternoon's session. I would like to thank all the witnesses for the time they've given us this afternoon, and we will now move into private session.